Welcome to lecture series on advanced geotechnical engineering. We introduced ourselves to module 4 and which is on stress strain relationship and the shear strength of soils. And this is lecture 2 in module 4. So we have discussed about the contents and then introduction to the Mohr circle analysis. So in this lecture we will try to do in the detailed discussion on the Mohr circle analysis and its applications and determination of the pole in the Mohr circle and how this can be used to find out the stress on any given plane within the element. And thereafter we will introduce ourselves to the principal stress space and the stress paths in PQ space. So as we have discussed, the Mohr circle is a geometric representation of the two dimensional stress state and is very useful to perform quick and efficient estimations. And it is also popularly used in geotechnical fields such as soil shear strength, that anyhow we are going to discuss, and earth pressures, wherein actuation of active conditions and passive conditions are discussed, and also in the bearing capacity theories. So it is often used to interpret the test data and analyze the complex geotechnical problems and predict the soil behavior. And in this, the pole point on the Mohr circle is a point so special that it can help to readily find the stresses on a specified plane by using the diagram instead of complicated computations. So the topic which we are going to discuss, the pole point on Mohr circle, is a point so special that it can help to readily find stresses on any specified plane by using diagram instead of complicated computation. Now this coming to the pole points, a pole is a unique point located on the periphery of the Mohr circle. The point of intersection of Mohr stress circle and line drawn to the pole parallel to a given plane gives the stresses on that plane. So the point of intersection of Mohr stress circle and the line drawn through the pole parallel to the given plane gives the stresses on that plane. So this pole point is also called as the origin of planes. So there are two ways the pole points can be established. One is by relating to the direction of action of stresses, the other one is the relating to the direction of the planes on which the stresses are acting. Suppose if there is a horizontal plane, if there is a normal stress acting on that, then we are referring an horizontal plane, and if there is a vertical plane on the element and the normal stress is acting on that, then that is also what we are actually referring as the direction of the plane on which the stresses are acting. Usually the pole point relating to the direction of the planes are in use. Usually the pole point relating to the direction of the planes are in use. The direction of the planes, whether it is horizontal or vertical, is in use. Now here consider the procedure to establish a pole point for stresses. So what we need to do is that we have to draw the Mohr circle on the tau sigma space by knowing the sigma z and tau zx and sigma x and tau xz. So these are actually sigma x is normal to the vertical plane, you can see here, and sigma z is horizontal, is actually normal to the horizontal plane, that is sigma z here, and this is tau zx. So if you look into this about the center of the element, if you take moments, we get that tau xz is equal to tau zx because we have to maintain the equilibrium of the element from the moment equilibrium point of view. So project the line, so with by knowing these two points, draw the Mohr circle on the tau sigma space, then from this point sigma z tau zx is acting in the direction of the vertical direction, drop a line wherever it actually cuts the Mohr circle, and that is actually pole point from the stresses. So in this direction, if you are able to cut, then this is actually pole point from the stresses. Similarly, next, if you look into this, from here, you know, when you have the sigma x, which is in the acting in the horizontal direction, the direction is in the horizontal direction, but it is acting on the vertical plane, then you know you actually get a point here which is again same PS. So this is actually pole point from the stresses. The projection of the line from the point sigma x tau xz in the line of action of sigma x, that is horizontal, till it intersects the circumference of the circle, or projection of the line from the point sigma z tau zx in the line of action of sigma z vertical, the both actually gives the pole point with reference to the one method of establishment that is actually called pole point for stresses. The pole points for the planes, that means that the projection of the line from the point sigma z tau zx. So here you can see that by following the usual procedure, we actually have drawn the Mohr circle, and here the sigma z and tau zx and sigma x tau xz. So from this point, so this is sigma z is actually acting, sigma z is acting which is perpendicular, but it is acting on the horizontal plane. So in the direction of this plane, draw a line you know the which is you know parallel to this this horizontal plane, and till it intersects the Mohr circle, and that point is regarded as the pole point. So the intersection point gives the pole point PP for planes. So what we can notice here is that this is the point pole PP, and from the definition of pole point from the planes. Similarly, when you look into the sigma x tau xz here. So here this is you know sigma x tau xz is you know this plane is vertical here. So in the direction of this vertical plane, draw the line till it actually intersects the point here. So it will be again you know when you draw in this horizontal direction or in this direction, you actually have a point here, and from this point when you put this, this is in again the pole point from the planes. Now when we join this this point with you know the major principal stress here sigma 1, the intercept with the sigma axis at tau is equal to 0 is the major principal stress, and here minor principal stress, that is sigma 3, which is here. So when you draw a line like this, when you draw a line you know from here to here, and on this plane there is you know minor principal plane is acting. On this plane, now the major principal plane is acting. Now, if you are actually trying to find out, wanted to find the stress on in a particular plane within the element, let us say an angle alpha within the element, that can be found out by just drawing or dropping a line such that you can actually get the stresses, that is sigma and tau and sigma at this particular any element state here. So with that, we'll be able to find out the stresses in the elements. The stress states in the elements at any given plane within the element. So in the Mohr stress circle, when we said that pole points for the planes, and which is actually usually adopted, wherein what we have to draw, how to you know establish a pole point is that you know project the line from the point sigma z tau zx in the direction of the plane on which the stresses are acting till it intersects the circumference of the circle. And the intersection point gives the pole point PP for planes. Now what we have further discussed is that when we join this with the major principal stress magnitude here, and this plane is nothing but the major principal plane on which the major principal stress is actually acting, and here on this is the you know minor principal plane. So these principal planes are the planes on which these shear stresses are zero. Principal planes or shearless planes are called principal planes, and we have major principal plane and minor principal plane, and you know in the two dimensional case where by ignoring the intermediate principal stress, what we say is that major principal stress and minor principal stress principal planes can be identified. Now from the pole of the Mohr circle is defined as thus. Now if a line is drawn from the pole to a point on the circle where the stresses are tau I and sigma I, then in that xz plane the line is parallel to the plane on which the tau I and sigma I act. So the definition whatever we have discussed is that if a line is drawn from the pole to a point on the circle where the stresses are tau I and sigma I, then in the xz plane the line is parallel to the plane on which the tau I and sigma I act. Now use of the pole point, if you look into it, is to basically to find out the stresses sigma c, sigma a, tau ac and tau ca on the plane on which is inclined at theta to the plane on which sigma z acts. So now you can see that this is you know the sigma z is actually acting on this plane and sigma x is actually acting on this vertical plane, and there is tau zx is acting here and tau xz is acting here. So in the step 1, locate the pole point for the planes extending point E horizontally. So what we do is that you locate the pole point, that is we know that the stress state here is the sigma z tau zx and sigma x tau xz. Construct the Mohr circle with this as the diameter, and from this you know the sigma z is actually acting on the horizontal plane. So extend this you know line, project this line till it intersects the periphery of the circle, and that is the circumference of the circle, then that point is regarded as the pole point PP. Now what we do is that locate the pole point for the planes extending point E horizontally in the direction of the plane on which the sigma z is actually acting, that is horizontal. So we have drawn the horizontal line. Then what we have to do in the step 2 is that draw a line parallel to the plane which sigma c acts. So now draw a line parallel to the plane on which sigma c acts. So this sigma c is actually acting at an angle, it's let us say that certain inclination. So draw a line parallel to the this line, and here you draw a line. So extend a line from point D through the center of the circle till it intersects the circle. So from here draw the circle so that we get the sigma a and tau ac, that is you know on these stress states, and then we get sigma sc and tau ca. So this is what we do, we have written, what drawn is that we have drawn a line parallel to this this plane on which the sigma c is acting. Now what we have established is that we established an element at the D and you know let us say D dash here, and these are the you know the stresses at this state are the sigma c and tau ca which are nothing but here, and here it indicates that sigma e, sigma a and you know tau ac. So when we join let us say again here to the major principal plane, major principal stress here, minor principal stress, then this will become the major principal plane and this will become the minor principal plane. Now this is actually shown diagrammatically here. Once again, use of the pole point to locate the stresses sigma and tau at an angle theta to the reference stress direction. So here what we have done is that we have got a Mohr circle on the tau sigma space, and we with the sigma z tau zx which are actually acting here, and sigma x and tau xz by following the sign conventions which are defined yesterday, we actually can defined in the previous lecture, we can actually draw a indicate this in tau sigma space and draw a Mohr circle with this as the diameter. Then the sigma, wherever it intersects the sigma axis, this will become the major principal stress that is measured from here origin to this point, and this is the magnitude that is measured from here to here, that is sigma 3. Now you know the stress point on the Mohr circle is actually now from the here we draw a line parallel to this, so you actually can locate this pole, that is PP, or you can draw a line parallel to this plane. So you write this vertical plane, you will actually again get from either from this or this, establish the origin of the planes. Then from here what we need to do is that we wanted to determine the stresses sigma c and tau ca at an angle theta, so draw a line parallel to the plane on which sigma c and tau ca are acting. So with that, what we have, what we get is that we get these stress states like sigma c from after locating d by drawing an angle theta below with the PPE, then you know drawing d and d dash passing through the center of the Mohr circle, we actually get the stress state sigma a tau a c, that is sigma a tau a c, and you know then we get sigma c and tau c a. So this by using this procedure like use of pole point P to locate the stresses sigma and sigma c and tau c a at an angle theta to the reference section is demonstrated in this particular slide. Now the fundamental relationships by the Mohr stress circle can be discussed. So here a tau sigma in space, a Mohr circle which is actually shown here, where you can see that the stresses are actually acting sigma 1 and sigma 3 are acting on this, sigma 1 is actually acting on OA plane OA, and sigma 3 is actually acting on plane OB, and which is inclined at an angle you can say that inclined at an angle theta. Okay. So what we need to do is that again by knowing sigma 1 and sigma 3, we can draw the Mohr circle, and from here to locate PP or OP, that is the pole, draw the from here draw the line parallel to this plane on which this is actually acting. So this is an inclined at theta, so draw a line, and from here what we can actually draw is that if you look into this, and the shear stress will be maximum here, that is tau max is equal to sigma 1 minus sigma 3 by 2, which is nothing but the radius of this Mohr circle, and this point is sigma 1 measured from here to here, and this point is sigma 3, the minor principal stress. So what we get is that this is the the major principal plane, and this is the minor principal plane, and the shear stress, principal shearing stress, is actually occurring at a the line joining this point to the point where the maximum shear stress occurs, that is 45 degrees. So we have tau max which is on the the upper portion of the Mohr circle, and then bottom portion of the Mohr circle. So the maximum shear stress, often called the principal shearing stresses, as a magnitude of sigma 1 minus sigma 3 by 2, and which equals the radius of the Mohr circle. So the maximum shearing stress, often called the principal shearing stress, has a magnitude of sigma 1 minus sigma 3 by 2, which equals the radius of the Mohr circle. So the principal shearing stresses occurs on planes inclined at 45 degrees. The principal shearing stress occurs on planes inclined at 45 degrees. The principal shearing stress, or the maximum shear stress, occurs on planes inclined at 45 degrees. Now the another aspect is that the conjugate shearing stresses, that means that the shearing stresses on planes at right angles to each other are numerically equal but are opposite sign. So numerically equal because the element has to be maintained equilibrium by when you take a moment about the center of the element, we get tau zx is equal to tau xz, or tau xy is equal to tau yx, or tau yz is equal to tau zy. So these stresses are called conjugate shearing stresses. So here the conjugate shearing stresses are represented here. So we can see that if you are having these shearing stresses at this point and at this point, so we call these are which is on the upper, they are equal in magnitude, but only thing is that they are opposite in the sign. So one is positive, other one is negative here. So this is indicated here, this is actually called, these two are called as conjugating shearing stresses. So these are conjugating shearing stresses. Now the another aspect is that what is the obliquity and the resultant stress. So the resultant stress on any plane has a magnitude expressed by we have an element, let us say sigma and tau. So the resultant is actually nothing but root over sigma square plus tau square at any particular point on the Mohr circle, and has an obliquity which is equal to tan inverse of tau by sigma. So if you look into, let us say that this is the point C on the Mohr circle which we are referring. Now what we do is that from the origin, that is where from here to this point, so this is actually called as the the maximum, the is the obliquity angle, that is, which is nothing but alpha is equal to tan inverse tau by sigma, tau by sigma, this is tau and then this is, this ordinate is sigma, and this magnitude is nothing but root over sigma square plus tau square, which is the resultant. So, the obliquity you know, angle of obliquity is nothing but alpha is equal to tan inverse tau by sigma. Now, further if you look into it in this particular slide, where has been shown that you know, we have got in the same situation that Mohr circle, but here if you look into this here, when indicate this sigma 1 and sigma 3 acting at an inclination theta. So, what we have drawn is that we located the pole, and from here you know, what we have drawn is that we try to determine the stresses on any plane at inclination theta. So, that is this point, point where it actually touches the you know, the point where it is tangential to this line, when you draw from the origin, and if the point where it actually gets tangential, and that point and this point when you join, and you know, when you look into that, this is also in the beginning. So, this angle is actually called as the this angle joining from this point to this point is actually called as the maximum angle of obliquity. So, the maximum of all the possible obliquity angles on various planes is called maximum angle of obliquity, which is alpha m. The maximum of all possible obliquity angles on the various planes is called as the maximum angle of obliquity, and the coordinates of the point of tangency are the stresses on the plane of maximum obliquity and is less than the plane of principal shear. So, if you look into this, the principal shear is nothing but the maximum shear stress. So, you know, here the maximum shear is, that means that the failure is most likely to happen, but you know, when you say that you know, the limiting obliquity is, that is a basically criterion which is used to you know, initiation of the slip, indicate the initiation of the slip. So, the maximum obliquity is you know, less than the plane of the you know, you can see that is less than the plane of the principal shear, because since the limiting obliquity is the criterion of the slip, and whereas in the plane of principal shear is actually liable to happen. So, the coordinates of the point of tangency are the stress on the plane of the maximum obliquity, and this which is actually you know, the angle which is joining to the maximum shear stress is actually less than this you know, maximum angle of obliquity. So, if you look into this you know, this is not the maximum shear stress, the maximum shear stress is here. So, here at the point of maximum shear stress with radius r is equal to sigma 1 minus sigma 3 by 2, the failure is actually most likely to happen, but here this point which actually you know, indicates the maximum limiting obliquity angle is basically is the criterion which is actually specified for initiation of the slip, and whereas in the plane of principal shear is actually is liable to happen. So, now consider an example where you know, we need to draw the Mohr stress circle at failure on cylindrical specimen of stiff clay with a shear strength of 100 kilopascals, and if the radial stress is obtained constant at 8, maintained constant at 80 kilopascals. By using the pole point method, find the inclination theta to the radial direction of the planes on which the shear stress is one half of the maximum shear stress, and the determine the normal stresses acting on this plane. So, we need to determine the magnitude of the normal stresses and acting on these planes, and the condition which is given is that find the inclination theta to the radial direction of the planes on which the shear stress is one half of the maximum shear stress. Now, what has been given is that the maximum shear strength which is nothing but 100 kilopascals. So, that means that the maximum ordinate is actually sigma 1 minus sigma 3 by 2, that is tau max is equal to 100. So, with this as you know, radius, sigma 1 minus sigma 3 by 2 as the radius, draw the Mohr circle on tau sigma space. So, then we have got the you know, maximum shear stress with you know, on the 100 kilopascals here minus 100 kilopascals here, and the circle when it actually intersects with sigma axis, at sigma 1 it is 280 kilopascals, and sigma 3 is 80 kilopascals. So tau max is the radius of the circle. So sigma 1 is equal to sigma 3 plus tau 2 tau max. So tau max is actually is given as 100. So with that what we can actually find out is that sigma 1, so which is nothing but 280. So the diameter of the Mohr circle is nothing but 280 minus 80, that is 200 kilopascals. The radius is nothing but tau max is equal to that is sigma 1 minus sigma 3 by 2, that is 100 kilopascals. So the plot you know Mohr circle based on the above information and radius and 2 points on the circle. Once we do that, now the condition has been given is that 50% of maximum shear stress, draw a line. That means that when you are actually doing the draw a line which is you know intersecting the Mohr circle. So draw a line at tau is equal to 50 kilopascals, which is half of tau max. Now as the principal stresses are acting on edges of sigma 3, so you know here this plane is actually horizontal because the cylindrical sample. So sigma 1 is acting on the horizontal plane, sigma 3 is acting on the minor principal plane. So this itself will become like a PP is nothing but the pole here. So from here draw the line, it intersects at you know at point where sigma 3 is identified, and that is point pole point PP. Now from here what has been asked is that the inclination of the plane on which tau is equal to tau max by 2, which we by drawing a line from here, this point is actually indicated by the condition which we have given, and with that we can actually get you know on this 15 degrees, and at this particular point we can actually get sigma n 15 as 267 kilopascals, 267 kilopascals, and another ordinate is nothing but 50 kilopascals. Then when we can see that when we draw a line at 75 degrees, now possible that because this point actually intersects at these 2 points. So when you draw the line here from the 75 degrees with the horizontal, it is at 75 degrees with horizontal, and this magnitude of the stress sigma 1 75 degrees indicates that 93 kilopascals. So draw the line you know from the pole to intersect the intersection 50 kilopascals, a line on the Mohr circle. So so what we have actually based on the you know the given data, we try to establish determine the normal stresses acting on these planes. Now the here with the given information, 2 planes are possible. So we could actually get for this same shear stress 2 different normal stresses can be seen. One is at plane incline at 75 degrees, the other one is actually at the you know 15 degrees. Now consider you know an example problem where the Mohr circle of the total stress and element having a size of 40 mm by 40 mm, it's a cube. So a 2 dimensional state has been actually represented here, and the x axis and z axis are actually shown within the element, and for elucidating you know the shear forces and all with mustard color filled you know rectangles are actually shown, basically to show you can see that this is you know conjugate shearing stress shear force F4 and this is the conjugate shear force F3. And so the shear the element is actually subjected to shear like this, and these are the normal stresses and these are the normal forces F2 and this is actually normal force F1. So in the given figure the normal loads are applied to the faces of the soil cube having 40 mm by 40 mm and 40 mm dimensions, and F1 is 0.45 kN, F2 is 0.3 kN, and the shear loads are F3 is equal to F4 is equal to 0.1 kilonewtons. The sides of the soil cube are each one is actually having 40 mm. To construct the Mohr circle of the total stress and find the magnitude of the principal total stresses and the light and the direction of the principal planes in the soil. So what we have been asked is that we have been given forces. So each area of the face is nothing but 40 mm by 40 mm. In meters it is you know when we convert into millimeters into meters, it is area of the each face is 0.016 meter square. So by putting, let us say, F1 divided by that area, we will get the the stress sigma z, and sigma x is nothing but F2 by this area. Then the we can get this shear stress F4 on this plane, on this plane, divided by F4 divided by that area, and similarly F3 divided by this area, you will get the shear stresses on the sample. So now what we do is that we determine sigma z, which is 281 kilonewton per meter square, and sigma x is 187.5 kilonewton per meter square. Now tau xz is equal to tau zx is equal to 0.1 divided by, that is due to F3 and F4. Okay. So with that we have got the the data which is given. Based on the given data, we establish a sigma z and sigma x, and tau xz and tau zx, which are actually acting on the element. Now what we have done is that by knowing the stress states here, that is the magnitudes are little bit different, but however they can be ignored. And so here with this stress state like 281.25 kilonewton per meter square and 62.5 kilonewton per meter square, and this point as well as this point by the appropriate using the sign convention, we can actually draw the Mohr circle and with on the tau sigma space which is drawn to the selected scale. Then what we can do is that from this, because it is actually acting on horizontal plane, so draw a line to locate the pole. So this is the point P, which is the pole. Now this is the major principal stress. The ordinate is with the given dimensions which are given in the figure. The sigma 1 magnitude is 306 kilopascals, and sigma 3 is 154 kilopascals, which is measured from here to here and which is measured from here to here. So the line joining this when you drop a line to this one, this is the major principal plane, is inclined at 26 degrees with the this horizontal line which is drawn within the Mohr circle to locate the plane. And this is inclined at 90 degrees plus 26, that is about 116 degrees, 90 plus 26, and this is nothing but the minor principal plane. So so in the given problem we have been asked to calculate the magnitude of the major principal plane and minor principal planes, and also the direction of the planes which are indicated in this particular problem, which is the solution which is actually given for the problem. Now another example, here if you look into it, there is an element which is actually subjected to a cylindrical element subjected to the minor principal stress is 12 kilopascals and major principal stress is 52 kilopascals. You can see that these elements are not having any shear stresses, so hence they can be called as shearless planes. So this is a major principal stress and minor principal stress. The major principal stress is actually acting on the horizontal plane and minor principal stress is actually acting on the vertical plane. So as can be noted here, the sigma 1 with the sigma 1 52 kilopascals and sigma 3, so with 52 minus 12, that is about 40 kilopascals as the diameter, draw the Mohr circle. Once you draw the Mohr circle, so this is the point A, which is on the sigma axis, which is 52 kilopascals is actually indicated here. This is the minor principal stress, so this is actually acting on the horizontal plane. So from here draw a line to locate the pole P. So this is the pole P. Now what we need to do is that we need to let us say that the angle alpha is 35 degrees. So on this this angle 35 degrees, when you draw from this point to this point, so point intersects at C. So at point C, when wherever it actually intersects the Mohr circle, we can actually interpret sigma A and tau A. So that is nothing but 39 kilopascals and this is 18.6 kilopascals. So what we have actually got from this problem is that we actually have for a given plane which is actually inclined at alpha is equal to 35 degrees within the element. So first we have drawn the Mohr circle based on the information which is given, that is sigma 1 is given 52 kilopascals, sigma 3 is given 12 kilopascals. So with 40 kilopascals as a diameter, we have drawn a Mohr circle, and then we have indicated identified the pole P, and from the pole P you know we can actually draw a line at 35 degrees. Suppose if it is let us say 60 degrees, then that will be line will be located at such as that point, this point, then you know this is the point where you know you can actually get the stresses in the element at the onset of failure at a particular plane of inclination. And another important point is that you know in this the major principal plane is this and minor principal plane is actually indicated by a line perpendicular to this major principal plane. So major principal plane is in horizontal here and minor principal plane is here, which is perpendicular to the major principal plane. Now the same procedure is actually explained here. Plot the Mohr circle to some convenient scale and establish the pole point or the origin of the planes. A line through the pole inclined at an angle alpha is equal to 35 degrees from the horizontal plane would be parallel to the plane of the element, and that is of interest, and the intersection is at point C, and from there we can actually calculate the sigma alpha, which is 39 kilopascals, and tau alpha is equal to 18.6 kilopascals, which are actually along the plane which is inclined at 35 degrees with the major principal plane. Now consider similar example. Only thing is that in this particular case the element in space is inclined at 20 degrees. That means that the element is actually considered within the space with 20 degrees inclination with the horizontal. So the element under same stresses have been considered, but only thing is that this element in space is actually subjected to an inclination of 20 degrees, and we are interested in along 35 degrees plane what are the state of the stresses. So with the given information, now with 52 kilopascals and 12 kilopascals, now draw the Mohr circle. So what we get is that we draw the Mohr circle. Now what will happen is that because the inclination of the plane of plane on which the major principal stress is actually acting is changed now. So because of that, so parallel to this plane the location of the pole point changes. Previously the pole point was here when it was horizontal, now it got lifted up. So you can see that draw a line from AP and where it actually intersects. So the pole is actually located here. So from here if you put this 35 degrees, then again it will intersect at sigma n is equal to 39 kilopascals and tau n is equal to 18.6 kilopascals. So this sigma 1, this is the major principal plane now and this is the minor principal plane with the magnitudes which are actually given like 12 kilopascals and 52 kilopascals. So this is the major principal plane and this is minor principal plane. So the resulting sigma alpha is equal to 39 kilopascals and tau alpha is equal to 18.6 kilopascals are same because nothing has changed except the orientation of the space of the element. So when you have the orientation of the element is actually changed within the space, then the internal stresses will not change, but the pole point locations and the inclinations of the planes depend upon the orientation of the element is under consideration. So now take another example wherein the stresses are actually shown in the figure below, wherein we can see that this is element and which is subjected to this is the horizontal plane where sigma v is equal to 6 megapascals, which is actually subjected here, and we have got tau is equal to 2 megapascals here, 2 megapascals, and this is minus 2 megapascals. This is the this element is under tension, and this element is this is actually the shear stress, which is minus 2 megapascals here and minus 2 megapascals here. So we have the in the vertical direction it is compression, and the lateral direction it is we have the element is under tension. So what we need to determine is that evaluate the stresses sigma alpha, tau alpha when alpha is equal to 30 degrees within the element and as shown in the element, and evaluate sigma 1 and sigma 3 when alpha is equal to 30 degrees. So we need to calculate what is the locate the maximum maximum principal stress and minor principal stress. So The procedure is that plot the state of the stress on the horizontal plane, that is 6,2 at point A, and note that the shear stress makes a clockwise moment about A. So the shear stress is actually making clockwise shear stress is actually making clockwise moment about A, So from the consideration which we have defined in the previous lecture, shear stress makes a clockwise moment about A. So therefore, when the clockwise moment, when the shear stress is actually making clockwise moment, then it is actually regarded as positive. And if you look into this here, for the A is the element outside the A is a point outside the element. So about this, if it actually makes a clockwise moment, it is regarded as the positive. So in this case, if you consider element A, it is actually making clockwise moment. But when you take this one, this particular one, this shear stress is actually making counterclockwise moment about this point within outside the element. So this is actually regarded as negative. So this point is actually negative, and this is negative, and again here this is making clockwise moment. So this is actually positive. So these two shear stresses are positive, and these two shear stresses are negative. So plot the point B -4, -2. The shear stress on the vertical plane is negative since it makes counterclockwise moment. So clockwise shear stresses are positive. So and counterclockwise shear stresses are negative. So point A and B are two points on the circle. So construct the Mohr circle with the center at 1,0, that is 1 MPa and 0 ordinate. Find the pole by drawing the horizontal line through A and or vertical line through B. And find the state of the stress on the planes inclined at alpha, that is 30 degrees, and the draw line PC. So this is actually explained here. So what we have done is that we know the stress states from the defined sign conventions. We have located the A, that is 6,2, which is written here. Plot the state of the stress on the horizontal plane 6,2 at point A. Note that the shear stress makes a clockwise moment about A, and therefore it is positive. So that we have located. And now to locate point B, what we have said is that plot point B -4, -2. The shear stresses on the vertical plane is negative since it makes a counterclockwise moment. So we have located here. So with this as the diameter and with the center as 1,0, we draw a Mohr circle on the tau sigma space. So now you can see that the origin is here, then the Mohr circle actually has extended to the negative portion also. Now you know what next step you need to do is that after having drawn the Mohr circle, find the pole by drawing the horizontal line through A. So draw the, from this known stress state here, draw the line horizontal, because this is on the known stress state is here. Draw the line parallel to this plane, so it intersects the Mohr circle at point P, or you can draw a vertical line through this in the parallel to this plane on which the stresses are acting. So it intersects at the P, so this is the pole P. So from here what we have been asked is that calculate the stresses at an inclination 30 degrees within the element. So from P with PA, draw a line which actually intersects PC. So the point C is nothing but we get the stress state, that is sigma n is 1.8 MPa, and the tau a is actually 5.3 MPa. But if you look into this, this particular portion m, which is sigma 1 minus sigma 3 by 2, which is nothing but plus or minus 5.4 MPa, and which is m and m dash, we actually have got these points here. This is the minimum response stress, this is the maximum shear, and this is the this is also a point of maximum shear. So this inclination of PM is actually 34 degrees, and this magnitude of this is actually about 5.4 MPa. Now the next issue is that to draw line passing through this point, this is nothing but the sigma 1 and this is sigma 3. So with this we can actually find out what is the magnitude of the sigma 1. So this sigma 1 magnitude is 6.4 MPa, and this is nothing but in tension, that is sigma 2 is equal to minus 4.4 megapascals. So this is the minor principal plane and this is the maximum principal plane. The inclinations with the planes are actually indicated here. So in the figure what I have been asked is that we actually need to find out the state of the stress when the element is actually having a plane inclined at alpha is equal to 30 degrees, and lines drawn from P to sigma 1 to sigma 3 establish the orientation of the major and minor principal planes. That we have actually done through here in this particular exercise in the problem, where we have actually identified and calculated what is the maximum principal stress and minor principal stress. And also when the given element is actually subjected to different state of stresses, and we have actually have tried to understand what is the how we can actually determine and interpret the several parameters very efficiently. Now as we know that the total stress is nothing but effective stress plus pore water pressure. So at a given condition, we can actually draw a different Mohs circles for total stresses and effective stresses. So here in this particular slide wherein we can actually see that Mohs circle for total and effective stresses. So here on a tau sigma plot, if you look into this, on the right hand side the circle in white color indicates the total stress circle, and this is nothing but the effective stress circle. So on the when we have sigma 1 as the major principal stress, sigma 3 as minor principal stress, with this sigma 1 minus sigma 3 as the diameter, draw the Mohr circle. Now this is the again the pole point here. Now from this point at an inclination theta, you can actually draw an element where sigma naught and tau naught tau theta are the the stresses on that particular point and that particular plane, which are actually acting sigma theta is acting perpendicular to this plane and tau theta is actually acting on this plane or along this plane. So but when we use sigma 1 dash is equal to sigma 1 minus u, where u is the pore water pressure, and sigma dash 3 is equal to sigma 3 minus u, when we do that the circle actually shifts to the left hand side. So in case of effective stress circle, which is on the left hand side of the total stress circle, and where the magnitude of the effective major principal stress is nothing but sigma 1 dash is equal to sigma 3 sigma 1 minus u, and as effective minor principal stress is nothing but sigma 3 dash is equal to sigma 3 minus u. So the difference is nothing but u. Again when we actually locate the pole point, the pole will not change, and from this inclination theta and this stress state sigma dash theta and tau dash theta, we can see that the difference between these two horizontally these two are separated by distance u, and you can see that both in effective stress circles and total stress states the Mohr circles are actually having identical diameters. So we can actually summarize the points like the effective stress circle has the same diameter as the total stress circle and is separated from it by the pore water pressure. The effective stress circle has the same diameter as the total stress circle and is separated by the pore water pressure, and the stresses tau dash theta and sigma dash theta are effective stresses acting on the plane inclined at angle theta. By examining the circles we note that tau dash theta is equal to tau theta and sigma dash theta is equal to sigma theta minus u. So what we can actually conclude is that for a given state of total stress, changes in pore water pressure have no effect on the effective shear stresses, they alter only the effective normal stresses. So one important conclusion which we have deduced here is that for a given state of total stress, the change in pore pressure have no effect on the effective shear stresses, they alter only the effective normal stresses. So this is actually represented here, tau dash theta is equal to tau theta, where you can see that the vertical ordinate this is identical to that of though the magnitudes are different, but vertical ordinate is actually tau dash theta is equal to tau theta, that is indicated here. And also sigma naught sigma dash theta is equal to sigma theta minus u. So the effective stress circle has the same diameter as the total stress circle, and is separated from it by the pore water pressure, and the stresses are you know tau dash theta and sigma dash theta, which are the effective stresses acting on the plane inclined at theta. So by examining the circles we can see that tau dash theta is equal to tau theta and sigma dash theta is equal to sigma theta minus u. So in the for a given state of the total stress, changes in the pore water pressures have no effect on the effective shear stresses, they alter only in the effective normal stresses. So in this particular lecture we actually have tried to understand you know how a you know the Mohr circles can be drawn, and then what are the applications of this, and then we try to establish the origin of the planes and pole the pole point P, and then we also have discussed that how we can actually determine the major principal planes and minor principal planes, and we can actually say that the principal planes are the ones where the shear stresses are zero, that is shearless planes are called principal planes. So while determining the shear strength of a soil, you know if you are able to create these conditions, then they are eligible to be called as the shearless planes or principal planes, and which is you know we will be discussing in the forthcoming lectures while discussing about the triaxial test. And then further we have discussed that the Mohr circles of the total and effective stresses, the effective stress circle and total stress circles, the diameters are identical, and again you know there is no, that is the reason why as such there is no tau dash theta. So tau dash or tau is equal to tau because it is equal, and only thing what actually gets you know different is that the sigma dash theta will actually change it as sigma dash theta is equal to sigma theta minus u. So for a given state of the total stress, the changes in pore water pressure have no effect on the effective shear stresses, and they are only alter the effective normal stresses. So we have discussed you know about the Mohr circles for the total and effective stresses. So we can conclude that for a given state of the total stress, the changes in pore water pressure have no effect on the effective shear stresses, they alter only the effective normal stresses, because from the demonstration here tau dash theta is equal to tau theta and sigma dash theta is equal to sigma theta minus u. Further we can actually look that use the pole construction on the effective stress Mohr circle to calculate the effective stresses on any plane is exactly same way as we use the pole construction to calculate the total stresses. So if you are having the effective stress conditions or effective stress Mohr circles also, the same way we can actually use the pole construction method. And another thing is that the position of the pole in the Mohr circle of effective stress is same as in the Mohr circle of the total stress, and the location of the principal planes of the total and effective stresses in soil are identical. So when we have got the total stress conditions and effective stress conditions, then what we said is that the pole construction, which is actually the procedure, is same, and the principal planes you know in the effective stress conditions and total stress condition, they remain same. That means that the position of the pole in major principal major circle of effective stress is same as the Mohr circle of total stress, and the location of the principal planes of total and effective stresses in soil are identical. So the positions of the pole in Mohr circle of effective stress is same as in the Mohr circle of total stress, and the locations of principal planes of total and effective stresses in the soil are identical. So the principal plane, so that can be seen from the diagram here. You know when you look into this here, the major principal plane is here and in the effective stress conditions, and minor principal plane here, it has not changed. Here you can see that this is the major principal plane even the total stress conditions, and here this is the minor principal plane, that is a perpendicular one in this case for the total stress conditions also, and the pole is here for the total stress condition, and here also the pole is here. So in a way what is actually changing is that sigma dash theta, which is actually nothing but you know sigma theta minus u. So the u is that pore water pressure, which is you know the separating for the normal stress only, but whereas you can see that the tau dash theta is equal to tau theta, that means that you know it will not affect the effective shear stresses. So this you know with this we actually have you know discussed in length about the Mohr circles for you know and then pole interpretations, and we connected to you know Mohr circles of the total and effective stresses.